and let you go. 2 Timothy chapter 2, and I want to read verse 1. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1. The Bible says, "Thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus." And I want to talk to you about that grace that's in Christ Jesus. He didn't say, "Thou therefore, my son, be strong in grace." It's in the grace. And where is it? That is in Christ Jesus. And there are two things about grace. First of all, I want you to know, grace, we call it, and the simple definition of it is, it's the unmerited favor of God. In other words, God showed you favor. You never earned it. You don't merit it. He showed you favor, grace. But there are two graces I want to mention first of all. I want you to notice something about, turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 9. 2 Corinthians chapter 9. In 2 Corinthians chapter 9, and notice in verse 8. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 8. "And God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that ye always, having all sufficiency in all things, may abound to every good work." God is able to make all favor, grace, all grace. Now there's grace in Christ Jesus. There's the grace of God that would be in Christ Jesus. But there's the grace of man. And when he's talking about God is able to make all grace abound toward you, grow, abound toward you, he's talking about not just the grace of the Lord, he's talking about the grace of man. Now let me give you an illustration. Turn back and look with me in Genesis. And notice in Genesis 39. Genesis 39. And notice this man here in Joseph. Genesis 39. Now folks, we want grace. We talk about grace. We call ourselves grace believers. Why? Because we believe that our salvation is by the grace of God. We didn't earn it. We didn't work for it. We don't work to keep it. It's all by the work of the Lord Jesus. And God showed us grace, favor, in allowing us to hear the message and saving us by His grace. "For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast." God's salvation is fixed so you have nothing to brag about. You have nothing to boast in. You have no goodness to declare, "This is why God saved me." No, sir. Your salvation is by His favor toward you based upon your faith in Jesus Christ being your Savior. And God saves you by His grace, His favor. You have nothing to do with it except believe it. Now look in Genesis 39. Here's Joseph. Joseph gets sold. His brothers hate him. They persecute him. They throw him in a dungeon or a pit where there's no water. And he's a type of the Lord Jesus Christ. Just as Joseph goes down in a pit, the Bible says, where there's no water, so does Christ go into a pit where there's no water. Just as Joseph was hated by his own, Jesus Christ came unto his own, and his own received him not. Joseph is a great type of the Lord Jesus Christ. I think there's about 120 some types about Joseph and his life to the Lord Jesus Christ. Now look at this thing. He says there, and Joseph gets sold. He gets into Egypt. He goes down there. And finally, God blesses him. Notice what happened. In verse 21, but the Lord was with Joseph. Did I tell you what chapter? 39:21. But the Lord was with Joseph and showed him mercy and gave him favor in the sight of the keeper of prison. He's put in prison. And so Potiphar's wife, he was over the captain of the Pharaoh's guard, and he was over his house. He was an administrator, so to speak. And that man, God showed him favor. Well, then his wife come along, and so she wanted Joseph to go to bed with her, and he wouldn't do it. And so she fixed it, hollered, and said, this man defiled me. This man tears his garment. Joseph flees out of the house from her. And so that man, they put him in prison. He's a goner. He was falsely accused, just like the Lord being falsely accused. On and on. But so Joseph bore the thing, goes into prison. But notice what happened. The Lord was with Joseph and showed him mercy and gave him favor, grace, in the sight of the keeper of the prison. Well, then that God made that prison man, the keeper of the prison, to look favorably toward Joseph, the grace of man. Another one. I don't want to go on. I'll tell you what, look in Psalms. We'll go to that one. Psalms. Psalms 5, I believe it is. And notice Psalms 5. Notice this favor, verse 12. Psalms 5:12. For thou, Lord, will bless the righteous with favor. Wilt thou compass him as with a shield? God will, you have your his grace, you're righteous in him, your salvation, but also he shows you, causes men, just like the keeper of the prison, to have favor toward Joseph. God will make all grace abound toward you in the life you live, and I believe that. I've seen it happen. Look in another one. Turn over to Daniel. One more. Daniel. Look in Daniel chapter 9. No, I'm sorry. Daniel 1. Verse 9, I believe it is. In Daniel. Look in verse 8. Daniel chapter 1, verse 8. Now Daniel is right after Ezekiel. You got Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and you'll come right on into Daniel. Daniel chapter 1, verse 8. But Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's meat, nor with the wine which he drank. Therefore he requested of the prince of the eunuchs that he might not defile himself. I see he's asking something this guy don't want to do. Now God that had brought Daniel, now watch what he said. Now God had brought Daniel into favor and tender love with the prince of the eunuchs. And of course, because of his favor and his love that he had toward Daniel, he let him go ahead and have a meal that Daniel wanted so he wouldn't defile himself. All I'm wanting you to see is, folks, you got people out there, you got boss men, you've got people that's over you, and God is able to cause them to be favorable toward you, that you might have all sufficiency in all things. That's what the Lord does. God Almighty, I believe with all of my heart, cares about His people, the body of Christ, in the dispensation of grace. Now, I want you to see this grace. Four things about the grace of God. Number one, God's grace. There's grace to save the vilest sinner. You know, I hear people talking about they're too bad to be saved. God don't want me. You'll never get so bad that God can't save you. I see people, and a lot of times me and June will watch that ID investigation on there. Sometimes they have, you know, crime, and watch them how they track them down. I like that. And I see some of the things that these people in real life have done. I imagine you talk to Joel and some of these guys in here that's law enforcement, and they could tell you some stories of some things that men and women do to other human beings in this world. And you'd think, how can anybody do that? I think about Hitler. I think about all the 6 million Jews that he put to death in gas chambers and stuff. I think about the serial killers out there that have killed people, innocent people, and destroyed their bodies, and just coldness and the black heart. You say, God save somebody like that. God would save somebody like that if they trust Christ as their Savior and believe that Jesus Christ died for their sins. And there might be some of them that have turned and to the Lord and changed their mind about themselves and realized they are a sinner and trust what that Jesus Christ had died for their sins and trust Him, and they'll be in heaven in glory someday along with everybody else. You say, I don't want to think about that. Well, I want to tell you something. When I say the vilest of sinners, there's nobody worse than Paul. He said, I'm the chief of sinners. Do you realize we're all vile? You know, James puts it like this. He said, if you break one of the least of the commandments, you're guilty of breaking them all. We say, well, we just tell a little white lie. You're just the same as a murderer. You're a sinner. We're all vile. Paul said that someday he's going to change our vile body. He said, there is none good, no, not one. He said that in my flesh there dwelleth no cleanness. Nothing good. We're vile sinners, but the grace of God can save people. Boy, isn't that something? People will never get so bad that they can't get saved. The only people that can get, God won't save, is those that get too good for God to save. Look over with me and look in 1 Timothy. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 15. This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptation that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. Paul was the, he had people killed, had them put to death. He even shared in them, gave his voice against them, called them the men and women and children in prison, stoned them, persecuted them. He said in verse 13, he said, who was before a blasphemer, persecutor, injurious? But I obtained mercy because I did it ignorantly in unbelief. Do you know when he says ignorantly in unbelief? Paul was a believer in God. But you see, with Paul, God started something different. And something was showed to him. Look in the passage there. Notice, look back in verse 11. He said, according to the glorious gospel of the blessed God, which was committed to my trust. And I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who hath enabled me, for that he counted me faithful, putting me into the ministry, who was before a blasphemer and a persecutor and injurious, but I obtained mercy because I did it ignorantly and unbelief. And the grace of our Lord was exceeding abundantly with faith and love which is in Christ Jesus. In other words, God could love somebody like Saul because of Christ Jesus. He could love somebody like me because in Christ Jesus. Folks, it's Christ Jesus. It's the Lord Jesus Christ. It's Him. It's God's Son that went to a cross, and there God sacrificed His Son for us. And if we trust Him, God can love us back and show us grace and forgive us of our sins and take us someday to glory. One of these days might be in 2017, I don't know. The Lord's coming back. What if it is this year? You know what 2017 shows me, tells me? That the calendar's off at least 17 years. Because a day with the Lord is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is one day. Let me tell you something. When that seventh day begins, see, God has like 6 days, and He rests the seventh. That sixth day, 6,000 years, the seventh thousand year, the millennial, is when God rests again. It's got to be close. You say, well, it could be another 1,000 years. Doubt that. Don't believe it's off that far. But anyway, second thing, turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. So God can save the vilest of sinners. Look in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Look in verse 8. The Bible says there in verse, and he was seen of me also as one born out of due time. For I am the least of the apostles, that am not meet to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God I am what I am. And His grace which was bestowed upon me was not in vain, but I labored more abundantly than they all. Yet not I, but the grace of God which was with me. That grace is what caused Paul to labor. That grace is his motive. That's what it excites. It excites to action. What motivated Paul? That God would show somebody like him grace. And that grace is what labored. He said, by the grace of God, I am what I am. And His grace was bestowed upon me was not in vain. Well, how could it be in vain if it didn't cause him to share it? If God saved you and you keep your mouth shut about it and you don't tell nobody about it and you don't testify and you don't support and you don't labor for him, then his labor, his gift to you was in vain. But Paul said, mine wasn't. He said, which was bestowed upon me was not in vain, but I labored more abundantly than they all. Yet not I, but the grace of God which was with me. Look over in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Don't y'all see what it is? It's that motive. Why don't I preach? Why do I want to tell people about the Lord Jesus Christ? Why do I want to share the gospel to people? Why do I want to teach the Word of God rightly divided? You say, for money? Are you kidding me? 40 years in the ministry and I had to work because people wouldn't support you. You had to work. Why did I do that? Why do you come up here on Sundays? It's got to be some reason. Why do we do what we do? We do it, I hope, out of this reason. Look in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 14. For the love of Christ constraineth us, because we thus judge that if one died for all, then we're all dead. Constraineth us. The love of Christ constraineth us. Look back in Acts. Acts 28. In Acts chapter 28. Paul telling the Jews there, and I'm interested in the constrainment. The love of Christ constraineth us. He says there in verse 18, in Acts 28:18, who when they had examined me, would have let me go. And he's talking about Paul, Agrippa and all of them back there when he's talking to them, giving them, and they're holding him. In Acts 22, he said, who, when they had examined me, would have let me go because there was no cause of death in me. But when the Jews spake against Paul and against what he was doing and spake against them letting him go, I was constrained to appeal to Caesar. What motivated him? He saw their what they was going to do. He was constrained. It was his motive. Well, what is our motive today? It's the love of Christ and the grace that God showed toward people like us. Why do I preach? Because of his love toward me. I look at myself. I'm a sorry, no count, good for nothing. I don't deserve to be saved. I don't deserve to have the Spirit of God living in me. I don't deserve to have the Word of God given to me. I don't deserve nothing like that. I deserve hell. I deserve the judgment of God. I deserve what God could lash out on me. But instead of him lashing out on me, he lashed out on his son. And his son loved me enough to go and die for me. And his son loved me enough to send somebody by to preach the gospel to me. I love the Lord for his love toward me. And if you don't, there's something wrong. Chances are you've never been saved. And never have experienced that love. The night I got saved, I realized I was a sinner. I tried to live as clean as a hound's tooth. I don't know how clean a hound's tooth is, but I ain't going to open their mouth to find out. But that's the old saying. Well, I tried to live a clean life. Tried to live without sin. But tonight I got saved. I saw how filthy I really was. I was despicable in my own eyes. And I said, God, I'm a sinner. And I didn't deserve it. But because of His love and the grace that He showed to me, that's what motivates me. That's what keeps me going. That's what gets me up and gets me in there. That's what gets me to reading my studying my Bible. That's what gets me on my knees of praying for the church, praying for my ministry, praying for different things. That's what does it. Why? His grace toward me. He was so gracious to me. That's the least that I could do for Him. You ever stop to think if God just moved His hand back from you? Do you ever stop to think what if the Lord just withdrew Himself? I thank God for what He did for me. It's my reason for service. Look with me in Romans chapter 5. Romans chapter 5. Notice in Romans 5. Romans 5 verse 5. Oh, by the way, let's read verse 2. He said, verse 2, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace. We have what we have by faith. Look what he says, wherein we stand and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Look down in verse 5. And hope maketh not ashamed. I want to ask you something. The Bible says in chapter 10, hang on to Romans 5 there, and look over in chapter 10. Romans chapter 10 is a principle. Romans 10. Notice what he says there. In Romans chapter 10. And I'm just going to read some of these verses here. He said, but what saith it in verse 8? The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is the word of faith which we preached. You'll find that word of faith back in chapter 4. Verses 3, 5, 9, you'll find that thing. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thine heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. You don't confess for salvation, you confess unto it. It's already happened. How's people going to know it if you don't tell it? They won't. But look what he says. Verse 11 is my verse. For the scripture saith, whosoever believeth on him shall not be what? Ashamed. Why would I want to be ashamed of the one that showed me so much grace and love? And that he loved me with a love that I can't measure. And a love that is everlasting. Why would I want to be ashamed of him? But look at verse 5. And hope maketh not ashamed. Back in Romans chapter 5 now. Romans 5 verse 5. Hope maketh not ashamed. Why? Because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost which is given unto us. You have the Spirit of Christ in you right now. In that body of flesh right now, you have the Spirit of Christ if you're saved. If any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he's none of his. We're sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise unto the day of redemption. He has sealed us in Christ. And if you have Christ in you, then God's Holy Spirit sheds that love. You realize the love that He had for you. And the grace that He showed you. That's why I do what I do. I hope that's why you do what you do. Then the third thing is grace to make men see what is the fellowship of the mystery. You know, it takes grace when you go against the grain. You know that? You go against religion, it takes grace. Look with me in Ephesians chapter 3. A lot of people don't have that grace. They won't let the Lord give it to them. You ever start to talk to somebody about the Lord and all of a sudden your heart just gets a pounding real big? We say, well, I just don't want to speak in pub. That ain't it. You can talk to them about the weather and it don't bother people a bit. You can go up to a vilest sinner and talk to him about the weather. Reckon it's going to rain today? Reckon it's going to snow today? Or, I don't know. I hadn't heard the weather. And this, or you can talk to him about racing or football, basketball, or all that stuff. Oh, yeah, just yak, 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 yak. But Jesus Christ's name mentions. Why is that? Why is it that people that say, I'm saved by the grace of God, find it hard to talk to somebody about the one that saved them? You know what? It's spelled with 5 letters. I better check that. It's called flesh. That old man that you inherited from Adam still wants to hide from God and hide behind their good works instead of accepting God's righteousness. That's why it's hard. But God gives grace. Look what He says in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 6. And verse 6 is the mystery, by the way, that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs and of the same body and partakers of His promise in Christ by the gospel, whereof I was made a minister according to the gift of the grace of God given unto me by the effectual working of His power. Unto me, who am less than the least of all saints. You ever feel like that? Every believer feels that way. I look at others and I say, I don't do nothing compared to other people. But I am in the ministry and you are in the ministry. You're in the body of Christ. And your position in there is just as important as anybody else's. It takes all the body to function. But He says, least of all saints, is this grace given? Why? That I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ and to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery which from the beginning of the world had been hid in God who created all things by Jesus Christ. God would have all men be saved. That's where the gospel comes in. And coming to the knowledge of the truth, that's where the body comes in teaching one another the mystery and right division. It takes grace to do that. That's our whole ministry here at Charity Bible Church, twofold ministry. To get people saved and to bring them under the knowledge of the truth of this Bible rightly divided. Let them know who their apostle is. Let them know that all the Bible's for us, but it's not all to us. And I guarantee you, there's probably somebody sitting in here that you don't really believe that. Well, it's true whether you believe it or not. The last thing is there's grace. I want to just spend a little minutes here. Grace in time of suffering. You know, we live in an evil world today, folks. Paul said that this time of perilous times, perilous, dangerous times. It's times that June was telling me about a car yesterday or day before going down I-85 going the wrong way. Bam. Fatalities. They were drunk. Alcohol involved. You're going up the road and here comes somebody that's impaired and or they're doing something, they're texting or they're take their eyes off the road and veer right in your lane of travel and hit and bam in eternity. Every car you meet, you're about 2 feet from death. Sometimes you're closer than that when somebody loves that line and hugs it and crosses it. So you're trying to, no, I'm trying to get you to realize that this life is short. But there's grace. And we live in troubling times. We live in times where people in this world would love to come into this assembly and blow us up. And if it wasn't for them getting caught, they might just do that. And then there's people in this world that don't care whether they live or die. They think that if they die for their God, then they're going to be rewarded and they could strap on dynamite, any explosive, walk in here, set it off, and blow us all in the eternity. Say, that'll never happen. It does happen in this world we live in. I think about them people sitting in a restaurant eating and enjoying a meal and all of a sudden the guy pushes the button and he blows everything to smithereens. Folks, we live in perilous times. Evil men and seducers wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. We living in religious times. Do you realize every war is fought because of religion? Think about it. All the terror in the world is over religion. The people that wants to kill you is religious people. They do it in the name of their God. And it's not only just the religion, but there's people out there that would love to walk in here and rob us, shoot us, kill us for the money you got. There's people out there that would do that and not give it no thought. I want you to turn to 2 Corinthians, and I want to close. We live in a dangerous world. We live in a world of suffering. We live in a world of where our bodies suffer. We live in a body of sin. We live in a body that has aches and pains. But there's grace. Look what he says there in 2 Corinthians chapter 12. He said, in talking about his revelation, he said, lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelations, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan to buffet me, and lest I should be exalted above measure. For this thing I besought the Lord thrice, that it might depart from me. And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. That's your weakness, not his. In other words, he is strength, and his strength is magnified when you're weak. And God gives you grace. Paul didn't get deliverance from that. He said it was a thorn in the flesh. Turn over with me and look in Galatians chapter 4. Galatians chapter 4, just a few pages over to the right. And notice in Galatians 4, he called it a temptation. He said in Galatians 4, he said, in my temptation, which was in my flesh, ye despised not, nor rejected, but received me as an angel of God, even as Christ Jesus. Where is then the blessing that ye spake of? In other words, when Paul first came, he looked at him as some, like an angel, a messenger of God. They revered his office. And then something happened. He said, for I bear you record that if it had been possible, ye would have plucked out your own eyes and have given them to me. Something about Paul's eyes, he called it a temptation in his flesh. Paul suffered and he prayed 3 times. It reminds me of Christ going and praying in the garden. It seemed like in the scriptures about 3 times of praying about something, you should stop and leave it with the Lord. And he said, my grace is sufficient for thee. God is able. Look back in chapter 1 Corinthians, in chapter 10, where Robbie was reading this morning, 1 Corinthians chapter 10. Verse 13, he said, verse 13, there hath no temptation taken you but such as common to man. Every man suffers like you suffer. Whether they're saved or lost, they suffer. You lose a loved one, sinners lose a loved one. Everybody's suffering is common. It's the same everywhere. The only difference is you got grace and they don't. He said, therefore there have no temptation taken you but such as common to man. But God is what? Faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that you're able, but will with the temptation. Now notice it says, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape, that ye may be able to bear it. He didn't say he'd take it away like Paul. He didn't take Paul's temptation away, but he gave him grace to bear it. That's what the Lord does. We suffer as a believer. We're in an evil world. We're in an evil body. We're going to suffer. We're going to have pain. We're going to have disappointment. We're going to have anguish, spiritual anguish. We're going to have physical anguish. We're going to suffer in this world. But God's grace and His faithfulness, He'll see you through it. That you're going to bear it. That's why he says those that lose a loved one, he says, sorrow not as those that have no hope. He didn't say you wouldn't sorrow. There's grace in suffering, folks. There's grace to save the vilest sinners. There's grace in suffering for the believer. Now, say, well, how'd I get it? You remember I read in verse 5? Romans chapter 5 verse 2, by faith we stand in that grace. You know, I liken it to we went and watched the Star Wars. Yeah, I was bad. I went to the movies. And you know, then in Star Wars, if you watch the Star Wars, it says, may the force be with you. And I remember Yoda talking about the Force, you know, one of them, how that it's all around us. It's there. That's the grace of God. The grace of God, you're in it. It's just claiming it by faith. It's believing it. May the grace of God be with you. Shake hands with one another and you can go.